shouted, Lord God Almighty.
Well, may God come in this morning.
Just a little while before day.
Daily, we share the same elevators, streets, corridors, stairways, sidewalks, highways, arenas, restrooms, lobbies, subways. In short, all public spaces. Even when access is gained by a ticket, the true price of the ticket is dependent on an implicit trust. The understood question is always, can I trust you? We signal indicating our desire to change lanes on the freeway. We cross streets without stop signs by catching the eye of the driver in the moving car. We drift off in waiting areas. We are dreaming on planes. We depend on those around us to keep us safe. This is our unspoken agreement. Between us, between strangers, our civic contract states, we will act in each other's best interest for no other reason than we are here together.
Beaver Creek 911, where's your emergency?
I'm at the Beaver Creek Walmart. There's a gentleman walking around with a gun in the store.
Has he got it pulled out?
Yeah, he's like pointing at people.
What does he look like?
He's a black male, probably about 6 foot tall.
Okay. What's he wearing?
Blue shirt, blue pants.
Where is he at now?
He's over in the pets.
Can I have your name, please?
My name is Ronald Ritchie.
The alliance we pledged is to one another. Assurance is taken. Can I trust you? Assurance is taken. Different from and similar to each other.
Sir, what's going on?
Gunshots in the store. Police officers are here. They're on the scene.
All right.
I just had any shots fired. Start an ambulance.
Whatever the precise thinking behind the question, the question is asked deep within us. We recognize that inevitably, I am going to have to put my trust in you.
Alright, doing what?
Walking by.
Okay.
Radio 12's out on that subject, the South Commission.
Walking by and doing what?
Well, you're making people nervous.
By walking by?
Yeah, they said you had your hands in your pockets.
Wow, walking by having your hands in your pockets makes people nervous to call the police when it's snowing outside?
They did.
Okay.
So are you okay?
I'm fine, or how about you?
I'm good.
Alright.
What are you up to today?
Walking with my hands in my pockets. Walking.
We are circling the understanding that daily we have to take a leap of faith regarding you. In order that we can go on believing in our mobility, trust is what pledging an allegiance secures. Public trust relies on both an implicit understanding and a mode of seeing. Someone is paying attention. Someone is watching. See?
Oh shit. Oh shit. They got their guns out. Oh, they just killed this man.
Damn.
Has he your license, please?
Get a guard! Get a guard!
If you see something, say something. Because we will trust you. Peace of mind gives us the ability to move through our day without fear. It keeps us in our rhythms. It gives us an air of confidence regarding an illusory control of the world around us. We drift off in waiting areas. We are dreaming on planes. We understand what will happen next. And this is crucial to a sense of well-being, even if this control is no control at all. When something occurs that disallows the taking for granted of one's own safety, when something happens, when that thing happens.
So what's your business with me right now?
I want to find out who you are and what the problem was.
There is no problem, that's the thing.
So talk to me,
let you know. Why do I have to let you know who I am? Who I am isn't
because
the problem.
Because that's what police do when they get called.
Well, I don't have to let you.
People.
Well, I know my rights, first off. Secondly, I don't have to let you know who I am if I hadn't broken any laws. I told him, I'm going to New Horizons to pick up my kids at 10 o'clock. I was sitting there for 10 minutes. Fully. Like, not before he walked up to me or anything. He walked up to me a minute after and got irate with me. So first off, that's a public area. And if there's no sign that doesn't say this is a private area, you can't sit here, so no one can tell me I can't sit there. If that's the case, then I can't sit here. The problem is I'm black. That's the problem.
We might find discomfort in a loss of comfort. We might lose an ease of movement around another. The perceived inability to trust another. No one wishes his or her sense of trust violated. Each time we pass through our public spaces, the question presents as a gentle nudge against an unconscious reliance on public trust. Would you, could you, should you trust? We are dozing in airports. We are dreaming on planes. As we daily move through our streets, in our parks, across bridges, in the aisles of stores, anywhere and everywhere we live, a simple truth and a basic understanding exists. When I walk toward you, it's one of the reasons I'm interested in. As we turn to each other, it's one of the reasons I'm interested in. Each second inside our unspoken question is one of the reasons I'm interested in. Can I trust you?
It's not trust if it's only in theory. My ambition was to talk to you tonight about citizenship, not just because it's an election season, but because Claudia and I both take the intensified violence that is the common substance of collective life now as a crisis of citizenship, ready to snap into view on any street corner or media encounter in scenes both remarkable and ordinary. We decided that poems would do better than a lecture to produce the texture citizenship's live present moment. Chicago. I sat down a few decades ago, and when I got up, there was a butt mark on the couch, a face with no nose to hook into the crack to keep me fixed. Nothing holds me here but the history of my attempt to be held, it turns out. And even that's over as fast as a snap, a harsh, or a simple look. Attachments like a book on the bookstore sidewalk that now, in the middle of a humid summer, feels coarse and bendy, worth not even a dollar. So I sit down again to write. The mark of history on my back turns my front to the wind, like Adorno said. He's on my mind this morning, writing a wrecked world back into endurable form. He's on my mind this morning, waiting in a lonely place for his collaborator, without whom there's only loose scrolling through a life built carefully just beyond the nose. A friend with the fro and aviators waves at me on the lake, his young son scrolling nearby on a scooter. The friendship has turned out to be slight. The kid looks away and awry, confident of love. Other people's confidence excites me. On a summer day in the early morning, the lakeside is full of it, a sense of pride that we all show up for movement that no one pays us for, like trivia games at the ballpark or memory at the dinner table that opens debates that don't matter. Some people are snobs about their small knowledge and lord it, but I'm a dog with a sock. Those pleasures are free and the fighting is all play, all winking takes and soft pauses relieved from the usual pushy wish for importance that we try to hide from the radar that judges desire. Stony Island story problems. Today I spent my entire month's pay on taxes, pet insurance, home insurance, and car insurance while the cat named Puck groomed himself on a chair I curb snatched in the 90s. Then I went to the store and bought $50 worth of trash bags, dental floss, apples, vanilla, and saltines. I was on my way to a sick friend with 2 pints of chicken soup and now 1 box of saltines. He makes $28,000 a year and Debt Busters is helping him pay $5,000 in parking tickets. Getting to him means passing the new dollar store on South Stony Island in the warehouse that used to be called Moo and Oink. No more cartoon caricatures of what the meat used to look like cheer up the drive down. Everything at the dollar store is manufactured with poison, then dispersed through middlemen to the people who scrape. Out front, we stand slurping our juice boxes and smoothies, making sex-like noises, because you know, at the end of the day, it's all about the drive to be excited without too much excitement. And living on together, which is its own work. He has 2 small dogs, one named Duchess. This is about a little farther down on Stony, about another 2 blocks. It's structural. Every house we lived in had a thing called a built-in. A built-in is an infrastructure for everyday order slotted into a closet whose frame would have read, "This house is mine," if things had signs like that saying their function. My father's change jar sat there, a large brandy snifter that was once for something else, a terrarium or some ceremonial candy. His watches lay there too, close to his cufflinks. And near them were his stacked white laundered shirts, each of which had cardboard in the back. And if you slid it out carefully, you would have a thing to draw on. Today I emptied mine for $27.23. His was full of quarters. There were never any lesser coins. The counting machine at the Jules supermarket always has a long line. It tithes 10% of what you pour into it, and it's involving to pour it in, to catch the spray and rejects, and to try again. The woman ahead of me glanced over and said, "Everything helps." She poured her change from 2 tall tins that had once held incense or Pringles. She pursed her lips in an almost smile, like she had just dodged a specific bullet. Airport poems. Enterprise zone. Near Midway Airport, there's an enterprise zone made of donut shops selling Chinese food and bilingual nail salons. There's a factory, too, stashed away from the main drag, where most American donuts are baked, regardless of the label. In its cafeteria, all the kids are skinny and the adults all fat, except for the alcoholics, who are bone dry and fierce in a way that would be desirable if those body shapes were worn by magazine models. My jovial table neighbor wears a big flower shirt that looks like an egg's been broken on it by a heart-shaped rock. The morning demons. We are all tired in a row, slouching in our humped coats. Mothers crouch to feed their children little spoons of yogurt. Adults read while digging oatmeal from small cardboard boxes. A few people say, fuck it, aloud and down the second donut. TSA cops jostle in loud. One of them asks if he can have a bit of the hand cream I've just pulled out. I grin with a thrust of fake chagrin and things seem easy for a second. Stranger gazing is a membrane that stretches things out as though I were constantly vomiting but had no mouth. Let's not ask for the moon. My neighbor is the father of two boys and two girls, and as he left them today at school, they stood still in the sun so beautifully, paper dolls. He waves, they wave, he retreats, and they pause. It's peaceful to watch an intimacy uncut by the inconvenient voice, like quick texts to and from a friend. Later, at the airport, a girl dragging a new black carry-on just tried to adorable her way into a job and play-by-played it noisily into a phone. Then she slumped down near her charger, wailing, "Oh, Jerry, Jerry, you tell me this now?" Some Chicago River poems. Right. A place in Chicago looks like Amsterdam, clean-aired as if it has always just rained, with seating areas covered so the river can be enjoyed. On the water, bags and boats float. White rock music from the year of my divorce echoes in the dark and light greenness of everything under the gray sky. It feels like a favorite color has been achieved. Workers smoke here. Lapping noises and a breeze too cool for summer make the rust on the nearby warehouse seem okay. Writing outside in the extended adolescence of an undecided dusk seems okay. The ducks swim nonchalant. Next poem's called Welcome to the Joke. Welcome to the Joke is a thing stand-up comedians say when people get the joke later. But you know, you always get the joke belatedly. Democracy kills me and it kills you, but it's not always the same death we die or do. Why bother calling it rat poison if it would kill us too? I like to play with high and low. What I'm saying is that I've been in a lot of elements. Yesterday at the stop, a fellow creature the gym ladies call that particular element asked for a hand. Out, job, shake, off. That's the door being female in public is walking through. Manners are in the neighborhood of rules you can get shot for disobeying around here. But mostly it's ice cream on the sidewalk and shrugging. One stop is a utopia. The chairs squeak loudly and the twisting kids love the unbearable music of their own butt power. They don't have a clue about humorlessness. They get fried and then they're happy. They hate change but whine from boredom. They enjoy cheesy starches and suck their yogurt out of brightly colored tubes. Charlie, you want a chicken wing? No thanks, a hot dog, I told you. But you can dip it in sauce just the way you like. He runs to the river and holds onto the fence as though it bars a freedom he can feel. He's smiling, not wanting. Older couples also try to get some heat on here. The old coot sitting two tables down meets a big blonde with grand arms and a fancy leather bag that could hold a whole roasted chicken. He's bored. He looks over and asks if I've read about debt. He wonders how people bear the pressure of it. He tells me he's 75 and was raised by Depression-era parents to avoid debt like the plague, but nowadays, it's just expected. I say, maybe people don't believe in later. Maybe they just believe in keeping now afloat. He's handsome and silver, no fat on him. I ask if he wants some water. I have extra. He says, I'm drinking wine in the middle of the day because my liver stopped working and why the hell not? A lot happens here. So many mouths opening and closing, so many flavors gone. And gone too, all the kisses parents gave to their children's sticky hands. Not dead, not nothing, but not things you can whip out later in the attempt to stardate life. Later, it's Friday, 7:30, and three times in 20 minutes, low blood sugar left turners cut me off in their late model hurry. Maybe it matters to get somewhere. Maybe they promised this time to be timely, but left late. Maybe they fear the passive wrath of their friends who will now have to mill around some loud, hot room waiting for a table to open. And it's Friday after work when people like to stop discerning time. A belated beauty knows she'll be welcomed, but even she speeds around the corner with the unblinking face of a bad driver. A sudden parking spot makes the traffic jump and spray recklessly around a stopped Civic. At the bar, a boy steps over to compliment my stout. He tells me he's in sales now and misses the office. Over there are the people he left behind. Go back, I suggest. You can never return, he says. I have to relearn life all over like a baby. It's damn lonely. On the highway overpass, teenagers stand waving late into the night. Maybe someone will get distracted by the joy and rear-end a semi. Maybe all the drivers will be so busy texting, they'll forget that the mechanical is encrusted on the living. Here's a Bridgeport poem. What does Webster say about soul? Everyone in this cafe is casual. The whole neighborhood is, except at 5 when the shiny-haired businessmen arrive to delay going home. At the next table, 2 women and a man are wearing the same jean and sweater outfits, pretty much. One woman's hair is tousled faux carelessly, and the other's is drawn into a ponytail. The man sports a baseball cap. Ponytail opens a large white box, inside of which are 3 perfectly round cakes, frosted white. A wedding is being planned. One cake is covered with the white sugar pearls we associate with festive decoration, the kind of thing that, like life, is supposed to taste good, but might break your teeth. One woman tastes the cake, and the other talks and waves her hands. The man gestures toward the tousled blonde as if to say, her happiness is all that matters. The salmon sweater of the consumer has more texture than the green top of the provider. Pictures are taken of the cakes to send to someone's mother. The baker wants to know if the cake will go onto a stand. She gestures at face height and higher. The couple furrows its brow with the gesture and their future. I'll end with some Halloweens. A carnival atmosphere reigns at the neighborhood school today, and kids run around the way they do every day, but wearing brighter colors and fearing, I can feel it, disappointment on the other side. A dull thread pulling them into knowing that it's all difficult, that they are difficult, that their relations and the chocolate in the candy bag are really not very delicious. A disappointed tongue is one thing, the optimistic and naughty collaboration that is the Halloween costume another. Some adult loves, hates, facilitates, or pragmatizes a child's wish. And there it is, a thing that will be repeated. A woman lugs a bowling ball right up to her neighbor's lawn and rolls it hard from between her legs, just like when she was little. She's overcome by the sight of her action. Her slow face grows cabbagey. Maybe they won't notice the defeated garden or the bent fence. Shadows move in a picture window beyond the lawn's carpet, dull to the event that has not yet become one. An act can never be withdrawn. On the street behind her, the Halloween festival goes on. The poor kids come early and stay late, rubbernecking and hungering to hunger.
So, hey everybody. Yeah, I didn't see the door open there.
Thank you.
shows, I don't ever know if I should, like, I always go through extreme moments of talking, extreme moments of playing. So I'm working on the middle ground. And especially, like, being around, like, people that actually listen to music more often than the average person. So welcome, everybody, and I'm Julia. The theme that really struck me, and that's part of the music I put together tonight, was the number, the word, I was going to say the number of trust, like trust has a number, maybe be zero if it had a number, but the word trust is like super, relevant to my life and everybody's life right now. I feel like we kind of all like share the same bubble of nakedness when it comes down to that simple thing. So that's kind of the theme of my program today too. And it's interesting meeting Claudia. Like I felt like she had a lot of trust. She seemed like a lady that had a great steelness about her. So, you guys are in for some surprises with her work and everything. And I don't know, like the word trust, like especially hearing, like watching the video, like watching how, how society's kind of like revolving right now in terms of like authority, like our illusion of authority, working on our, you know, the society as a whole. I don't know, and then like the just the trust of like human life in itself, you know? I told you I talk a lot, right? All right, so this next piece I have is called Seven Things to Know, and it's very much along the same lines of, trust, belonging, or the ability to be able to, like, I don't know, security, you know? The same kind of security that we all feel, nothing in particular, nothing too intellectual, you know? So, I hope you guys enjoy it. Thank you. because I remember, like, back in the day, like, the witch burnings. Like, when people, like, back in the day, like, the heretics were people that, like, either, like, express themselves over much, too much, or did some type of, like, sorcery with their expression. And, like, one of the things that I like about, like, looking at history and, like, dealing with, understanding how, like, we attack other people so easily when it's foreign is, like, wondering, like, how, like, we're, I don't know, maybe, like, there's something in our blood that, like, maybe, like, I try to understand race and division sometimes. Like, I think maybe it's, like, a tradition thing. Maybe we know, like, where we're inclined to already, like, predetermined to be inclined to something. And maybe, like, an inclination kind of just rules us for a bit. And then when we see somebody else, we almost, it's almost like that memory of, like, what if or something, you know? Like, like, quantum physics kind of puts that into, like, you know, the idea of, like non-local particles happening in space. We can't really pick out where they're at in time, but they're already similar but yet distant. And the fact that they're distant is because they repel each other because they have a history already. And so it's interesting. And I think maybe, you know, we're like atoms with brains, basically, and blood and flesh. Okay, you guys are hard to talk to. You know? Really. Anyway, so this was going to be relative to what I'm playing next. And it's this song that I put this arrangement to. And it's a jazz standard. And jazz is obviously the history of this soil, and pretty much mine, too. I mean, metaphorically speaking, and probably literally, you know. This is The Shadow of Your Smile, and I hope you guys enjoy it. All right?
Thank you. I bring you a report from Michigan, which is the setting of this piece. It's dedicated to three generations of Black girls and women killed in domestic spaces in Southeast Michigan by white vigilantes and cops. Aura Rosser, Renisha McBride, Ayanna Stanley Jones. The largest porch in the world wraps around the Grand Hotel on Mackinac Island. From this porch and its hundreds of rocking chairs, as you look out over the Great Lake and say it looks like an ocean, a sense that anything is possible deepens the sun spreading on blue water. For a long time, Black workers had their own hotel and weren't otherwise allowed on the island after dark when the workday was over. You probably know that Detroit is the most segregated city in America. Within city limits, it's also the least diverse. White people live in a wraparound porch called the suburbs. Green, no solicitors, wet paint, guard dog. A porch cannot completely hide what is on the inside. About 40 minutes outside Detroit, my neighborhood listserv instructs us, please lock your doors and keep your porch lights on. Call the police for even minor incidents where a girl is just walking around or on your porch knocking on your door. Which side of the porch are you on? Come in or you'll catch your death. What does a porch sound like in the rainy early morning hours when you need help? You were driving home in the dark and got into an accident. You hit your head and you need help. You need a porch light. A porch is thank you, slow and open. A light would not exist if hospitality did not need it. I mean if hostility did not. Survival borrows form from the past, which is not even past. Not even forgotten, not even past.
Do you want to smart take?
Yes, I just shot somebody on my front porch.
The weak point is the one who speaks, even if the main point is the one on the porch. What's your point? What's your breaking point? What do you imagine pointing at you? To be on point is a military term, meaning to be the first one in with a gun. The point is not to cross the line.
Yes, I just shot somebody on my front porch with a shotgun banging on my door.
The weak point is the one who speaks, even if the main point is the one on the porch. Case in point, on a porch you have two directions. Point blank, on point, on the line, in the line of, just as a legal term, meaning power or right, you adjust. A porch raises but cannot settle questions of belonging. A porch is never yours alone. Whose porch do you mean? I mean the porch within the porch. Porch time, porch swing, porch kiss, wet towels, muddy shoes, porch talk, pot shot. The porch you are standing on, the largest porch in the world. Turn on the light, pull the cord, pull the... What city are you in? The first porches in America were on the front of shotgun houses. It's where Milkman finds Pilot in Detroit in a black dress peeling an orange. You too are standing on a soft threshold, wind stirring the bushes, stirring up a feeling of overlooking, being overlooked or on an overlook. Your double vision means seeing things. When you are on a porch, memory collects and swarms. Its bloodstain is a memorial you step over daily. Step into the sensation of safety, as if everything you know could be gently suspended. You are calm here. You panic here. Gravitationally, a porch pulls you in and into a time, T nations through their mouths. They sit in judgment. You read their eyes for watching God in a porch state, being at home and not being at home. The temperature swings, coated pillars and furrow. Even when you are at home, covered with a blanket in a dark room asleep, you are not home. You are on a white porch, temporarily permitted, or in the middle of the night, can you imagine a knock on the door? Even if you can't imagine it, story ends the same. A porch used to be where you told stories. Now it is a stage that screens trained us to watch. The opening shot captures a quiet home at midnight. From the porch, look inside the ground floor apartment where TV emits the only light. A grandmother watches as her granddaughter sleeps, both on the sofa with her legs touching. They do not realize TV is looking back at them, along with the film crew, a half dozen masked SWAT team officers, and the imaginary everyone who tunes in to the AV reality show, The First 48. The conceit of the show is that homicide detectives have 48 hours to crack a murder case before the trail goes cold. Watching to keep everyone alive. No one checks to see if the door is locked. Instead, they use a battering ram to smash through it. Then they throw a flashbang grenade through the window, a diversionary device in a time of war. An explosion of light and blinding noise breaks into the girl's dreaming. The grenade lands so close to her that her blanket ignites. She wakes up just as the officer on point bursts into the room. What? Her blanket is burning. What's that look on her face? What are you looking at? The show star fires a single shot. The bullet strikes the burning girl in the neck. The cameras catch it. Police do not realize yet that they have thrown the grenade into the wrong apartment. They do not realize the man the cops are trying to find is in the upstairs unit. Just the day before, the best friend of the murdered man took a bullet in the head while clipping a friend's hair on the front porch, his hair half cut. The episode of The First 48 never aired. The film footage became evidence in a series of mistrials that led the officer, the detective, on the show and off, back to his job. Come onto the porch. It's raining. Tears, the judge cried. She cried to convict you. It's not about race, she said. Your tears, so white, they were raining. And a porch is, and a porch isn't. Where you were standing, when the system is moving in.
I'm going to go screaming as somebody's
coming, to see it coming, to be visible. You mean you can't see it? You're surprised when it comes. You wanted to say something. The house was dark. You mean you strained to hear her, and her words embarrassed you. You corrected yourself. You mean ingest. You took it in stride on the wrong side. You're not, you mean you just don't know what to say. You mean you can't imagine. You're just listening. It takes, you need time. After a while, you just, what did you do? Are you sure is how you keep saying it? You have no problem. You mean the arc of justice. You believe in equality and freedom. You believe, what did you say?
American runner. I've come to this headless finch, tangled in sunlight and kudzu vine along the Raritan, just off the river General Washington, boated and proud with the teeth of former slaves in his head, to place my body in the way of something other than my death. But even Orpheus couldn't manage this, the Maenads tossing his head into a river, the head singing into its own oblivion. A sheaf of wheat blown from a graveyard into the foyer of an elementary school, and the hum of a truck's tread that sought to crush me flat as Gilgamesh's sacred lute crow and crowd my running head. But I'm fortunate to have a buffalo's patience for finding water in a jaundiced plain, and a woman who can drive an angel out of me or a gazelle skin stretched over a log. I know the ascension of dragging a lake for a tenor's tongue and watching a body descend and rise into a parade of clay and bells. I come from a land where a dead hog stretched out over a picnic table means good harvest, and we only lost one child to a tree. The head sweetening the pines into a night of shifting chants. O song of the river blood, O blood of the river song. I pawned my box of precious medicines for a bottle of brown liquor, rent money, and several mink coats. I envy the sea turtle's ability to be at home while traveling in and out of exile, in and out of the blood, salting the ocean in paradise. There is no terror like this, making a soul out of the sound of your aunt hanging from a joust in the middle of a barn, her lash gashes produced and reproduced like a Gershwin tune. I love you, Porgy. I love you, Porgy. There is no terror like this, running along the Raritan, watching snakes climb out of the water and run through the forest like men. My name is Roger Reeves, and I'm a poet. And I'm responding to Citizen, thinking about the multiplicity of voices. And so what I mean by that is, what I'm really interested in is, I grew up in this church that believed in speaking in tongues. And so I was really interested in this idea of like speaking in tongues and what that can do inside of poems. So the poem that I'm going to read from mostly is this long poem where in which the character or the speaker, the persona, is a lynch man. And as his body comes apart, it's taken by animals, he begins to sort of feel, speak, experience from these sort of different body parts. As his body sinks into the earth, he begins to sort of move in and out of time. So I'm going to read the sections that most play with sort of glossolalia. And so this next section is called Water, New Orleans, 2005. And so it came without flaw or contradiction, with wood and beam and ballast of light. And the bodies came with it, through the house, through the walls, as if a voice, Citizen, how does it feel to be a problem? And before we could answer, the dead rushed on, rushed out as if called, chattered somewhere else in the neighborhood, rushed on, rushed out, as if guests were coming, and they needed to vacuum the skin left on the carpet, as if the dead did not understand they occupied the afterlife as guests. The afterlife in its brief darkness and sudden transgressions of light ask each of its denizens, how does it feel to be a problem? And then the water spoke with its many tongues. Shall I enter, thou bruised and open window? May God have mercy where I will not. Rough riders, we in here. Ain't going nowhere, ain't running nowhere. Wobbly, 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 what? Drop it like it's hot. Oh, shin shala, oh, batala, I kandela, cauterize this shadow, because everything at the edges rots. How does it feel to be a problem? And then we stopped listening because no one wants to hear a lullaby or a window slamming shut when one is about to go down, cow down in death, heft of the final blow. May we call it a soul. Even the mansions wave their tired shutters at the storm, like the old women in church with their funeral fans. My God, bring me what wants in. My God, your grotesque has always been the modernity I seek. How does it feel to be a problem? The last lover, the ornery cricket goring the walls of a washed out house, the lottery ticket thrown from a car window, the date book, the burning date tree, a flock of pit bulls boxed and thrown into a creek, the universe unforthcoming, a spade clapped against a childish nation's head, Plato's uterus, mistress on the floor, the night of box elders bending against the weight of a hanged body. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost of Gethsemane. Oh, Obatala, Shinshala, Data, Dayata, Noose, not me, not Gory Island, lonely, lunatic, lost, but not loss. Loose will, won't he do it? Garden of Gethsemane, up in this tree, no star or crown, but crowned and crowed and cow down and row out, reach ratchet, and work and way down in Congo Square, work, way down in Egypt land, work, oh won't he do it, work, where the fire go, ghost, go missing, ghost, go Atlantic, oh over, over, oh tis taint, tagged and torn down and torn up and shook song, oh shuffle on, shuffle on, shuffle on, over Red Rover, send all the black folks over and under, and arg, oh ee, ah, thwap, thwap. How much longer can I make black suffering eloquent? And so this next section, I would call this the new critics. They come in gold, in the rabbit light, and the aboriginal blue of night, in the Gras and Mardi, on Fat Tuesday, when the devils and glittering Indians sleep in their gold, tiaras and broken feathers, and the beads and sequins littering the last of our sight spreads out beneath us, until the spreading out ends in a thumb smudging ash onto our foreheads, as if the morning reinvents the dog without feathers into a star, the river into a thread of a man snapping inside of a man, frame within frame, the liturgy of suffering, or is it the suffering of liturgy? Regardless, they come, without feathers, wearing broad petals over their mouths, clapping at the indolent light, tenting our cities, the voices in the trees, this opacity, what shall we call it? Metaphysical cleavage? Ineffable? The nomadic tendency of the self to wander outside of itself to see itself? Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. When there was three, there was four in the fire. Shadrach, Meshach, and a bad Negro. Ashram, Suleiman, Cajun, Ho Chi Minh. Slim Kim in the cutthroat gang. Histrophes, epistrophes, apostrophing in the gloss of glossolalia. Holy rolling raconteur. Measure, Meister, Kant. What moral effect might this night have on the human reason of man? Let's check the weather. Erica say, I'm clever, built with the bone structure of a smoke and paper god. What darkness within is not, but also without. What river, not also a noose? They come with sticks, poking at the eyes of any body of water. They come faces painted white, some wearing gorilla masks, some gorilla-ing. Gunboats gouging the Ganges of Mississippi or Senegambia or Suicide Bed-Stuy. Where you at? Where you at? Has anyone found Kurtz or his heart? The horror, this horror. You don't make no goddamn sense, says my uncle. If all she has to write about is being black, then she won't have much to write about, says Lewis Simpson of Gwendolyn Brooks. Simple motherfucker, they coming on the backs of the riot dogs in Ferguson, Missouri, swinging sledgehammers, disobeying the phantoms of commerce, in the shapeless shadow, in the rabbit light, in the difficulty to think at the end of the day, in the trees around you, in the humming and humped up, in the confusion of cardinal directions, in the children's black pilgrim hats, in the play about Harriet Jacobs fleeing her master in the eaves of the attic above her master's house. In these geographies of empire, they come banging their anvil tongues with the ache of a woodshed slipping off its foundation. They come hanging upon the shawl of the wind, whispering, throw away the lights, the definitions, and say what you see in the dark.
Good evening. For my moment, I would like you you to ponder on the sounds of forced migration. And also maybe on the idea that vibrations affect our biology. Our biology is passed on from millions of years of life on Earth. And this is a closed cycle we live in. Where does the energy go?
Thank you.
Some years, there exists a wanting to escape. You floating above your certain ache. Still the ache coexists. Call that the imminent you. You are you even before you grow into understanding you are not worth anything. Worthless, not worth you. Even as your own weight insists, you are here, fighting off the weight of non-existence. And still this life parts your lids. You see, you seeing your extending hand as a falling wave. I, they, he, she, we, you turn, only to discover the encounter to be alien to this place. Wait. The patience is in the living. Time opens out to you. The opening between you and you, occupied, zoned, for an encounter. Given the histories of you and you, and always, who is this you? The start of you each day, a presence already. Hey you. Slipping down, burying the you buried within. You are everywhere and you are nowhere. In the day, the outside comes in. Then you, hey you, overheard in the moonlight, overcome in the moonlight. Soon you're sitting around publicly listening when you hear this. What happens to you doesn't belong to you, only half concerns you. He's speaking of the legionnaires in Claire Denis'
film both travail, and you are pulled back into the body of you, receiving the nothing gaze. The world out there insisting on this only half concerns you. What happens to you doesn't belong to you. Only half concerns you. It's not yours, not yours only. And still a world begins its furious erasure. Who do you think you are, saying I to me? You nothing, you nobody, you. A body in the world drowns in it. Hey you, all our fevered history won't instill insight, won't turn a body conscious, won't make that look in the eyes say yes, though there is nothing to solve, even as each moment is an answer. Don't say I, if it means so little, holds the little, forming no one. You're not sick, you're injured, you ache for the rest of life. How to care for the injured body, the kind of body that can't hold the content it is living. And where is the safest place when that place must be someplace other than in the body? Even now, your voice entangles this mouth, whose words are here as pulse, strumming shut out, shut up, shut in. You cannot say. A body translates its you. You there, hey you, even as it loses the location of its mouth. When you lay your body in the body entered, as if skin and bone were public places, when you lay your body in the body entered, as if you're the ground you walk on. You know no memory should live in these memories, becoming the body of you. You slow all existence down with your call, detectable only as sky. The night's yawn absorbs you as you lie down at the wrong angle to the sun. Ready already to let go your hand. Wait with me. Though the waiting, wait up, might take until nothing whatsoever was done. To be left, not alone, the only wish. To call you out, to call out you. Who shouted you? You. You shouted you. You the murmur in the air. You sometimes sounding like you. You sometimes saying you. Go nowhere. Be no one but you first. Nobody notices. Only you've known. You're not sick. Not crazy, not angry, not sad. It's just this. You're injured. Everything shaded, everything darkened, everything shattered. Is the stripped, is the struck, is the trace, is the aftertaste. I, they, he, she, we, you. Were too concluded yesterday to know whatever was done could also be done, was also done, was never done. The worst injury is feeling you don't belong so much to you. Good night, everyone.